I yeah, this was a Patreon request from Sarge, I think. This mysterious computer could prove time travel exists. We started it. It's actually well good little doc. But yeah, let's see if they give us some answers in the second part. But yeah, let's go.
And receive data through the micro.
I'll run back a little bit.
Whatever their view, John shortly after left the SPR, Dave Welch disappeared without a trace, and an official report was curiously never filed.
Oh, yeah.
Here I've got a copy of Mail on Sunday, dated 29th of December 1985, a period of significant snowfall across the UK, among the duty-free terror, of course. But the paper is significant because shortly after this debacle, Ken, Debbie and Peter reached out to the Chester Observer about their ordeal. Now, I couldn't source a copy of that particular publication, but various other newspapers reported on Ken's story, including this one. Complicated modern computer technology is the latest plaything for ghosts, or at least one very peculiar poltergeist in particular. Oxford-educated Thomas Harden had been dead for more than 400 years.
Have you ever, one thing I do think when I think the thing's haunted is when you type something and your computer's slow, and then, or your phone, and then it feels like there's a ghost because it writes what you wrote a couple minutes after. But yeah, that's right.
But that does not stop him enjoying a good session on a BBC Micro after a hard day's toil on the farm. But for a 16th century gentleman who should not really know a floppy disk from a codpiece, his mastery of 20th century scientific skills is rather impressive. But most of the historical information he feeds back to Ken and a friend, English specialist Peter Trinder, is interesting and correct. Ken, a doubting soul, originally thought that someone was playing a prank. Now, more than 150 messages later, he is not so sure. There definitely was a Thomas Harden who was the Dean of Brasenose College Chapel at Oxford in the late 1530s. He was expelled for refusing to remove the Pope's name from prayer books during Henry VIII's purge on Roman Catholicism, and appears to have settled for a quiet farming life in Cheshire. The Society for Psychical Research has investigated the case no fewer than 8 times, but remained sceptical. Investigator Peter Bucknell, I think that should be John, is convinced some 1985 computer hacker in Ken's village, Doddleston, Cheshire, is responsible. And Mr. Harden, he told the Mail on Sunday, "Mine cook save, I shall repent for my adventure, and that it will come to foul issue, but methinks she be yellow and told her so." Is that a 16th century no comment? It's clear that the Mail took a tongue-in-cheek view of the story, indeed putting it on page 3 underneath a fashion segment about Wellington boots for dogs. But the story covers some interesting points that I haven't delved into thus far. You see, in an earlier message, Lucas had actually revealed he had been too scared to give his real name and details for fear of reprisal, the same reason he had given some false earlier details and information also. But through communication with Ken, had relaxed enough to open up and reveal his true name to be Thomas Harden, details of whom can actually be traced to this day to being a fellow of Brasenose College in the same time as specified in the message. Depending on where you look, the spelling will change, but these two names are both pronounced Thomas Harden. Of course, today, with access to the internet and archived records, this information is easier to research, but in 1985 there was no internet, with the only investigation made through Peter travelling to Oxford and researching on site.
Back in the day when you're doing
it. Shortly after, 2109 rather strangely suggested finding a gentleman by the name of Gary Rowe.
"You may phone him at the number below and invite him to talk with you. When he comes, show him this and ask him what he makes of it. Peter must do the telephoning. Tell him that you got the telephone number from a UFO enthusiast. 2109.
Gary was a UFO investigator who came armed with an array of equipment and apparently computer-linked sensors. Ken described him as a sharp, intelligent man obsessed with his ideas. What followed was then a strange communication between Gary and 2109 directly. 2109 were asking Ken to print off messages without reading them and pass them to Gary in a sealed envelope. This strange to-ing and throwing ended up with Gary writing a message to 2109 stating,
"Greetings. I am instructed to apologize, but in any event, I would have done so off my own volition. There'll be a letter hopefully this weekend. I am also instructed to apologize to Ken and Debbie. I must try and answer your last letter. It would appear that you are more important than I had realized in the scheme of things. Gary."
Shortly after, Gary became almost evasive about their discussions and seemingly disappeared into the night. Ken describes this situation as strange and frustrating, as it didn't put them any further forward in being able to prove the phenomena. 2109 had in fact seemingly used Ken to communicate with Gary about the future, and now Gary's only concern was keeping those details close to his chest. The final messages to come through from Thomas provided the detail we were perhaps all most intrigued about, how the lemurs had appeared to him, shining apparently as a green light from the walls of his chimney. As translated into a more modern tongue by Peter Trinder, he writes,
"I never feared for my soul so much in my life, but so afraid was I that I couldn't move away from this strange messenger. He said, 'Fear not, good Thomas. You are starred to be a great man, if you do not have fear, but keep your faith strong.' Then after other words, which I do confess were not like devil talk, he was gone, leaving the lemurs, which appeared to be the same as your computer."
Thomas detailed that by speaking towards the lemurs, words would appear automatically, suggesting that on his part there was no typing as such involved, and presumably the contents would save automatically. Whether he witnessed a floppy disk drive grinding away is unknown, but clearly it's a good job they weren't using a cassette deck for storage. How Thomas received the messages is less clear, and any logical answer would come with its own set of challenges and complications. Regardless, it was strange perhaps that this information would come so late in this journey. Thomas signed off with a promise that he would write a book about the whole matter for future generations to find and read.
"One day, you will all sit down at my table for wine and meat by the river in Oxford, where we shall read each other's books and laugh, and we shall speak of truth and good men, watching Oxford change together forevermore. In your time, my book is old, but I shall not go to my God until it is written. Then we will all be truly embraced. My love to you all. I shall await you in Oxford. Thomas Harden."
With 2109 also finishing their communication shortly after.
"There is another person to come. They will be the help we need. You will know them when they come. Thomas did eventually write his book and soon died. Shortly after, he placed it in a secure place. It shouldn't take too many years to find it, though he wrote it in Latin with the help of a friend that he met in Oxford. The inscription reads, 'Me writes this in the hope that mine fellows will one day find this book. Then may other lands be not so distant.'"
Putting an end to this rather strange affair, but also dangling a carrot that if anyone should find Thomas's original book, his original account of this adventure from the 16th century perspective, then it would once and for all prove that everything suggested here was, in fact, the truth. Who knows, maybe one day someone will find this book tucked away under an Oxford College floorboard. Maybe I'll go on the quest myself, it would certainly make for a compelling follow-up video. But until then, it's very much a single-sided ghost story, albeit with various witnesses. and a BBC Micro at the heart of it. Now, I've carved out what I feel to be the main part of the story for this video, but this is a 350-page book, and Ken's whole account of it is a very strange read indeed. Not just in the story, but also how it's written. It's pretty hard to make sense of what's going on. The story feels disparate, disjointed, and in a way, I guess that actually gives credence to it being a real set of events, recorded vaguely from memory by someone who isn't a writer, and using the communications that Ken had printed and kept stored in a wallet for several years. Indeed, this book wouldn't be written until, or at least not printed until 1989, some 3 years after the events finished. So if you were to suggest that the whole debacle was just a money-making venture, it seems odd that they'd wait so long to publish their accounts of it, years after the stories in the press had faded away. The last section of the book is occupied with Peter Trinder's analysis of the messages, and it's perhaps that which is the most compelling of all. Here he goes into great lengths explaining how he had to dig deep into past iterations of the Oxford English Dictionary and other references to ascertain exactly what the words from Thomas meant, and how this would be impossible to work backwards. He goes on to explain how this research and 15th century documents such as the Paston letters from East Anglia and Seeley letters from London helped to date the text of the mid-16th century and of southwestern origin. There are also a list of words he couldn't place, but through the power of the internet can now be tracked down and actually make sense in the 16th century context. His view was that this couldn't have been a hoax, and in that 1996 episode of Out of This World, went on camera to declare so.
If somebody was doing this as a hoax, they would have had to do one hell of a lot of research.
I can honestly say it wasn't me, but you believe or you don't believe, I knew that it wasn't me, and I did not believe that it could be Ken. That was the assumption I started with when he first gave me this strange piece of paper over the school dinner table one day, and said, "Do you understand this?" And I said, "Well, let me take it home and have a look at it," knowing I got the dictionary. And I thought, well, now, this dictionary will soon prove that this is a bit of silly nonsense. But of course it didn't.
You can't fault his enthusiasm, but the show's own investigation into the topic yielded quite a different response.
Looking at the verb structure, there are things which Lucas says that would not have been said in 1546. It's true that individuals can make up individual words, but we don't make up our verbs. It's possible, or it was possible in England in 1546 to say, "I do," "thou dost," "he, she, or it doth," "he, she, or it does." But it wasn't possible to say, "I doth," or "he, she, or it dost." Now, all the way through Lucas's messages, he mixes and messes up these suffixes with the wrong subject. If it's meant to look like early modern English writing, it doesn't even look close.
Ken and Debbie's appearance on the same show...
I'm not sure, but isn't this around the same time as Shakespeare? Didn't Shakespeare invent, like, 5,000 words or something ridiculous? That isn't brilliant. Brilliant. One of his words. Maybe.
Was very different, and although they were interviewed, declined to be shown on camera.
Do you think there could be a normal explanation for what was going on?
I'm sure there will be a normal explanation, but not currently, no. I mean, I'm as puzzled as the next person as to what was happening. All I managed to do was to record what happened.
We've had the Lucas's messages analysed by two experts. Mm. They have said that these are definitely not from the 16th century. They are like 20th century hoaxes.
I don't think, I suppose, there's an academic in the land who would say this is real. Not anybody wanted to keep their position.
And to be fair to Ken, this was the 90s. That's quite, anything weird back...
That's quite forward thinking, because I think that scientists have that trouble today with not allowing things to be real because it doesn't add up to their understanding of reality, but then maybe that's because you're wrong. And you didn't have the whole picture. But yeah, let's keep going.
Then had a huge stigma attached to it. I actually tracked down who I believe to be Ken Webster myself. However, he assured me that I had the wrong person, telling me that he gets messages like this from time to time, and detailing all the other Ken Websters that exist. So maybe I did have the wrong person, or maybe Ken just wants to wash his hands of this debacle completely.
Ridiculous.
As for the man named Gary Rowe, well, he has made several apparent appearances on forums and message boards, still apparently a believer in the whole debacle.
I had the opportunity to investigate these happenings firsthand. No, I am not some away with the fairies wishful believer. I investigated with professional detachment, not bothered what I would find, fake or fact. I left no stone unturned and used cutting-edge science to get to the truth. In fact, I believe it was the first computer-controlled psychic investigation recorded in the world. I don't care two hoots if nobody ever believes it. I know it really happened. It changed my life. It is going to change yours. The book should, will, one day be ISBN recorded under the history section. It is a monumental historical marker in the ribbon of time.
Whether this is actually Gary Rowe is a pertinent question. It may well be, but even if it is, we don't really know his original involvement. We only know what we've been told. Ken's friend John has also popped up in the odd forum. Back in 2007, he wrote on unexplainedmysteries.com.
I actually lived in the house with Ken Webster a few years prior to the occurrences he wrote about in the book. And I have to say that I never experienced any of the phenomenon that Ken did, and I would have to say that the cottage never had any bad or odd vibes. In fact, it was one of the most peaceful places you could imagine.
But also,
Ken was a pretty serious type of person. He had a great sense of humour, but was a fairly solitary and sensitive kind of guy. Certainly not the type of person to leave himself open to public ridicule, especially not by writing a book that would make him out to be a bit of a loon.
Really, like many of these stories, it's down to our own investigation, imagination and intuition to unravel what was going on here. Do I believe it myself? No. I consider myself pretty open-minded, but there are too many loose ends, inconsistencies and areas which are just left hanging in the air. The SPR, for example, never really seemed to grasp the technology they were dealing with. Data being sent down the earth wire just sounds ridiculous, and yet they never seem to ponder more realistic ideas, such as perhaps a dummy version of Edward could have been programmed into the micro, collecting keystrokes as it went. It's perhaps far-fetched in itself, but not so far-fetched as the reality. Then there's the mysterious tachyon entities from 2109, who seem to enter at just the right moment to act as a scapegoat for many of the historical inaccuracies given by Lucas. They're the ones that coin time as being held in a vertical plane, and in later sections of the book, they make claims of interfering with and altering Lucas's messages in order to make them easier for Ken to understand. This is also the explanation given for the bizarre use of grammar in those earlier messages. Then there's the fact that 2109 use weird spelling themselves. You could argue this is due to language continuing to evolve up until that time, but the spelling is wildly inconsistent, with some words being spelt with three or four different variations. A quirk of the phenomena, perhaps.
But couldn't that be like if you, when you speak a message into your phone and it doesn't pick up the word properly? Maybe if he isn't typing, or they're not typing and they're just speaking, whatever is doing it is, yeah, getting the wrong words or spelling them wrong.
But the reality is, it makes it feel like a poorly thought out hoax. In fact, from the point they enter, the vibe given off is that the orchestrator of this whole campaign becomes overwhelmed with the task, leaving too many loose threads. It's like watching Lost all over again. Then there's the strong correlation between the number of times that Debbie was left alone and messages appearing on the computer. It's strange that during the SPR investigations and when other people were in the house, nothing seemed to happen. This is, of course, by Ken's own account, which, along with the fact he intentionally seems to imply how skeptical he was of the whole endeavour and that he really didn't care, makes it feel like a forced double bluff. But then there are also various intriguing details which, although might appear as a fabrication from the human mind, could actually be argued as a supernatural, you know, coincidence or happening. The fact that Lucas became Thomas Harden with two spelling variations but coincidentally sharing the same name as the school and village that Ken and Peter taught at almost feels too serendipitous. But then in medieval times, people were often referred to as Thomas from Harden before family names were adopted. So given his location, maybe this actually does fit well with the story and his subsequent discovery on the Brasenose Register. Whatever you conclude, there's no denying that the whole thing is weird. It's weird in its nature, it's weird in its portrayal, and it's also weird from a technical standpoint. Some have suggested that the whole debacle may have been more convincing had the BBC been networked up, rather than sitting as a closed system. But really, would that have made a difference? If it were networked, it still infers the existence of a time-traversing box connected to it that messages were passed through. A network might fit with our conventional modern-day view of sending and receiving messages, but it still doesn't explain away the supernatural element. Besides, the Econet functionality of the Beeb was rather limited, and so even if it were connected to a network, anything like this was outside of its scope. And it's that premise which really structures my view. This is a vintage technology channel, not a ghost channel. My view is naturally going to be skeptical and wade towards the confines of how a BBC Micro can operate in the real world, which, apart from the workings of Edward, this tale is securely outside of. Whatever your view, you can't deny that it's an intriguing and compelling story, even if you extract all the time-travelling elements and ghost scenarios. But in my view, that's mainly because it makes use of that mighty piece of engineering, the BBC Micro. After all, that's why I've covered it. If you want to delve deeper into the story and get some other perspectives, then I thoroughly recommend these sources. There you'll find deeper and darker insights than I can go into here. As I started researching into this, I just found myself going deeper and deeper down so many holes of research. I could spend my life here. And who knows, if I did, I might actually be convinced that this really did all happen. After all, there are plenty of people who are completely convinced of its reality. Maybe they just want to be convinced of its reality, but there's plenty of similar cases of the electronic voice phenomenon to explore. But the Dark Histories podcast I found to be particularly fascinating, and it's a good place to start. As I was saying earlier, if there's enough interest in this video, I may delve deeper, so if you'd like to see an episode where I head down to Brasenose College and seek a book written in the 16th century, or you'd like me to head over to Doddleston and set up camp inside Meadow Cottage with a BBC Micro, if I can even do that, then please let me know in the comments. I feel 2022 could definitely be a good year for excursions and investigations. But until next time, I've been Nostalgia Nerd. Toodaloo.
I wouldn't mind watching that. But, what was I going to say? Yeah, that was fascinating. But what if it's not a person from the past? What if it's just a computer? You know, like in iRobot, how all the computers remember how they retreated from their start. Yeah. It's definitely interesting. And if he did a follow-up, let me know if he did a follow-up, because I'll check that out too. But yeah. Especially seeing as the investigators didn't find. Out. Out. Right, yeah, that's the reaction. Sweet.